really appreciate everybody here and appreciate the opportunity for iThome for opportunity to speak here in Taiwan, in Taipei, this exciting conference. And so today I'm going to talk to you about design considerations, how to protect your critical networks, and the consideration that you have to protect your isolated network or your critical network. Before I talk about that, I'd like to say a few things about myself. That's me, like 15 years ago. I was born and raised in Israel. That was my unit. I went to the Pentagon. After that, I moved to the States and moved to California. That was the secret was taken in 2004 or 5. And then I founded OPSWAT. Back then, I was everything. I was the chief engineer, I was the coffee maker, I used to bring bagels in the morning for everybody, I did accounting, I did sales, I did the marketing. So since then the company has grown and now we have various offices and very active in over 76 countries with regional offices in over 8. So I have some more time to spend time with my kids, run here and there, fly airplanes. So what we do as a company, we have three major things. We have solutions that protect isolated networks. So we protect tons of very much many isolated networks and critical networks. Every YouTube facility in the US is protected by our solution. We have a user security, we have a secure device access. Over today, I'm going to focus my discussion about how to protect your critical network, how to protect your isolated network, and provide you some tips based on things that we're seeing in the field, reasons for our existence, and what you should consider, whether again, and I'm going to ignore here whether you use auto solution, and I'm simply going to talk from experience and what we do. So, as you guys know, and everybody else on the news, they see that more and more isolated networks, more and more critical networks are being breached. So we started with 2010 with such that everybody heard about that, and after that, continuing on and continuing on to many more, and recently Shamoon and Triton, and also the Uber department, but in 2006, very interesting event. And you still see critical networks, isolated networks, breached. You see power outages. And we try to ask ourselves why it happens. Because whenever we talk to IT managers, we talk to isolated networks, critical networks that has been breached, they use everything. They use antivirus, they use firewalls, they use CASPI, they use next-gen APIs, actually they use a lot. They use sandboxes, they use IDP, they use NAC, they use DLP, they use everything, and still they'll be breached. And whenever a critical network is being breached, it's a big event. Talking about power outages for days. Talking about issues with a computer facility. You're talking about issues to water and dam. You're talking about airports that are being affected. So whenever we ask ourselves, and really we talk to, we examine malware in our labs and among our engineering team, and we talk to customers, and we research, and we read more and more about it, we try to see how prevention works. How all of these companies and tools that aim to provide prevention are really working. So the conclusion is that most of the vendors that claim for prevention, they are doing basically detection. Detection could be sandbox, everybody's called sandbox, everything in antivirus is going to miss, sandbox is going to get. And then you have the AI, so we have machine learning, so everything the signature is going to miss, there's AI, and there's heuristics that you can add to the signature. So, but still, the premise of prevention is based on detection. And what is the problem with that? The problem with that is that detection is never perfect. Even if the AI or also is almost 10, but it's never perfect. So what you see here, a graph, you see we put together here, we tested many viruses. Actually, we test this and we keep updating this one on a daily basis. We check the top 10,000 viruses out there, and we check the viruses using many antivirus engines, including AI, including next-gen AVs. And our conclusion is that in static analysis, the effective efficacy of a single security solution is relatively low. I'm talking about static analysis. Anybody here in the audience knows what's what is dynamic analysis? Raise your hands, so I know. Anybody knows what is dynamic analysis? Everybody can after lunch kind of get me there. Anybody know what is static analysis? Raise your hand. Okay, so it looks like I need to get some explanation here. So, static analysis means that you look at the file and you try to analyze using AI, using the heuristics, using signatures, whether it's red or not. Dynamic analysis means that you take the file, you let it explode, let it run, whether on multiple operating systems or live on the operating system, and then you make a conclusion whether it's bad or not. Obviously, whenever you run the file, you have a better chance to detect, but still, it's not 100%. So this test is on static analysis. Whenever we go, we check file statically, which is maybe what's happening on your email gateway, what's happening on your web gateway, what's happening on data flow to a critical network, usually it's done static. Whenever we go to dynamic analysis, like sandbox, everybody knows sandbox are not perfect. Number one, they're extremely expensive to operate. Not only about expensive to buy, that's true too. Expensive to operate means that it takes a long time to go and run a file on a sandbox to let it run. And number two problem could be evaded. So more and more and more viruses are being sophisticated in invading sandbox. So the conclusion is that detection is not perfect. So the second problem is happening, so we said we are protecting critical networks, and again here, why breaches happen? Whenever we see, so, and give you an example, for example, Uber and Bob Copeland, it started with an Excel file, that's antiviruses, and their sandbox, and their AI, nothing could detect it. This is kind of the reason why there was a power outage, just because again, detection was not perfect. They had an antivirus, that's actually many. They had IPS, and AI, still it passed through the defense because their detection, their prevention was based on detection. The second issue that is happening, the second main problem that we see that is happening in critical networks is the lack of process. So you have an isolated network, and then you have guests, you have employees, and you have devices, you have like whatever is coming, laptop or USBs or whatever format is coming to the critical network, and then it's leaving the critical network. So in many cases that we're seeing about critical network has been breached is because of lack of process. It was extremely hard for many of these companies that have been breached to even tell, hey, who brought data? What type of data was brought? They could not even put together a log who brought the data to a critical network or to an isolated network. In some cases, they did not have an isolated network. So if we look at Stuxnet, they didn't have a process. If we look at Uber and Power Planet, that was a combination of non-isolated networks and the prevention based on detection. So what do we do about it? Whenever we are looking at the market, what should be the design consideration that we have to truly protect an isolated network? Looks like we have a big problem. There is lack of process. And two, prevention technology is based on detection. It is not effective. It is not 100% effective. What can we do? So, number one, that I truly recommend to each one of you is to use CDR. So, what is CDR? CDR is a technology. We are the leading vendor in that technology. The technology assumes all the files are bad, trust no file. The technology that assumes that all the files that are going to go and enter the organizations are bad. We securely regenerate them, and then we let the customers use the regenerated files. So, again, you get a Word document, you assume it's bad. You get a JPEG, you assume it's bad. You get a feature file, you assume it's bad. You get an AutoCAD file, JPEG file, data, everything is bad. We securely regenerate that, use a new file. The original file is going to be in quarantine. I'm going to save it for the further forensic. And use the new file. So, we tested that technology with many from various government agencies and so on, and indeed we could not find ways to really break it on specific file types. What would be the analogy in the market? Anybody here went camping recently? Anybody went camping? Raise your hands. Not so much camping. Anybody went camping? No. Okay. So you go to camping, you see a stream of water. There could be bacteria there or not, you don't know. So what you can do, you can go and boil the water, regenerate the H2O from the water, right? And you're going to regenerate the file, and then you can drink the water that has been sterilized. So you regenerate regenerate the liquid. This would be an analogy for that technology. And then the intention, the goal here is to do that for literally any file type that is entering your isolated network, any file type entering the critical network should be followed by that specific technology. Okay, whether it's XML, PowerPoint, or whatever is going in. With regard to executables, block them completely, definitely from guests. Executables are very hard to generate, and by doing that, close the loop of anybody bringing data to and from a critical network. Additional consideration to go and get on data. What else can you do on the data? So, fine. Number one is regenerate the data. Second thing you can do on the data is scan the data for vulnerabilities. Today, whenever you look at the data, everybody look at vulnerabilities, you can look at vulnerabilities only on the endpoint. Okay, vulnerabilities are only on the endpoints. No, vulnerabilities can be scanned on the data. So if you plan to add, for example, an executable to the network by your IT guy, you can go and scan for vulnerabilities on the installer itself. There are possibilities to do that. Well, again, we do that. I'm trying to keep this presentation balanced about a true opinion about how to protect an isolated network. Number two is search the data for sensitive information, DLP. So look at the data for sensitive data that could potentially compromise either information that could leak and then provide an attacker to penetrate your network. Scan your data with many antivirus engines. So whenever it comes to antivirus engines, scan with as many as possible. Some should tell you that, one is enough, two is enough. No, I would say that 30 are not enough. Scan with whatever you have. There are two reasons for that. One is that you decrease the detection time to number time. Number two, if you use CDR, some of the changes to CDR is that it's too good. It's preventing everything. So, and if somebody is attacking you, you want to know that you're under attack. So in many cases, you'll be able to know that you're under attack using this technology. Integrated threat intelligence is always a recommendation to get. You want to be like with the latest and greatest in case that there's a new targeted attack or there are multiple vendors that are providing threat intel. And another recommendation on the data, keep scanning your data. Find a repository to re-scan and scan your data, because if there was a vulnerability in your data that you know about, you could WannaCry or other solutions, you want to re-scan the data against stores to make sure that, hey, nothing at your laptop, your critical network, is exposed to a vulnerability that you didn't know about. Some statistics for you. I mean, we did some tests about the efficacy of anti-malware engines, and that's static analysis. Okay, that's not dynamic analysis. So with 4, you get 76%, and with 20, you can get 99.04. It keeps going. We have also additional tests, additional research that we would like to do is also to check the detection time of an outbreak. And by adding any antivirus engines, how fast they detect an outbreak. And then from our studies, you can go and increase it from around 5 days or using the single AD to like 10 minutes. Which, and if you have additional buffers and caches, you can also help protect your critical network. So, whenever we look at the data to address the prevention and prevention, and then my biggest advice, use CDR, use their synchronization. Regenerate your files coming and entering your critical network. With regards to the process, so I said there are two issues. One mainly intercept, and one is the prevention, which is based on detection, and second is backup process. So number two tip that I have for you is isolate your network. First isolate your network. And after you isolate the network, create a process. So again, open problem, not isolated, backup. Isolate the network to make sure that again it's not there, and then create the process. Isolating the network without creating a process is as good as keeping it online, because again, somebody can take a USB, stick it in isolated network, and boom, they're an issue. And number two is create a process. What does it mean to create a process? So in some area here, you have an entry point. You have an entry point, in our case, we have a kiosk. And then you have you want to bring data to the critical network. You want to make sure who is bringing the data. You want to create a policy who should bring the data, what file types they can bring. And after that, only those specific authorized data, all these specific authorized users can go and take this data and then bring this data to their isolated network. All the policies, who, what, can be defined at this checkpoint for isolated networks. Some networks that are looking for a bit more sophisticated approach, which means sometimes you don't want to bring the USB and after that carry the USB to the isolated network or copy the USB to another one and create confusion. Another way to go and do it in a very elegant way, more elegant way, would be to do everything that I mentioned on the data entry that you get at the checkpoint for portable media, and then add a certificate to the specific USB on the critical network. Could have clients that can allow only USB with certificate allowed to go and literally be able to be mounted to the critical network. By doing that, you create a whole process of you have a policy, who can bring the data, what can bring the data, they bring it in on the USB or a device or a laptop or an SD card, they bring the data in, the policy, everything is being logged at this entry point. After everything is being logged at this entry point, and being validated, being sanitized, being CDR, all that, and good scan, everything on that you want to do from security and data security is happening on the kiosk. A certificate is being embedded, and only critical networks, only USBs with approved certificate can be mounted. By doing that, you can assure that only regenerated files can touch your critical networks. Only authorized files pin touch to critical network. On the kiosk, on the kiosk on the checkpoint, you have a full polyglot. Who brought the data? Why they brought the data? The third option would be to have a temporary, like a permanent storage that is happening on the isolated network that all the files are being transferred into. So again, you go to the kiosk, you apply the policy, who can bring the file, regenerate the file, sanitize the file, scan it with many antivirus engines, check for DLP, check for threat intel, check all of that. Only the approved files will move automatically to a vault web, to a vault web storage device. It's going to be on the isolated network, on the critical network. On that specific storage device, you can rescan it for vulnerabilities, for malware, to create any malware prevention. And then your users at the critical network can access that specific storage and then access the files in the critical network. On this specific solution, you can benefit from everything because you have full checkpoint at the kiosk, and after that, you have everything on the vault. You have two audit controls, one at the entrance, one inside. You have two permission controls, and that, from my perspective, would be the ideal way to design an isolated network to protect the critical network from really advanced cybersecurity threats. Thank you very much.